الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وبعد. So this is inshallah will be hopefully the last session that we will have talking about the story of fiqh or the history of legislation. We covered, I believe, to a great extent, the time of the revelation of the during the lifetime of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Then we moved on to the second stage, which is the life of the companions of the Sahaba of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, mainly the four rightly guided caliphs, al-Khulafa al-Rashidun. So that's roughly speaking from year 11 after Hijrah to year 40 after Hijrah. And then the third stage is the stage of al-Khilafa al-Umayyah, the Umayyad Caliphate, which, as we said roughly as well, we can say started around 40 until the moment of 120, 130. That's the third stage that we studied in the development and the evolution of fiqh. And then al-Khilafa al-Abbasiyah, around al-Khilafa al-Abbasiyah, which is the Abbasid Caliphate, from the year, let's say roughly 130 to around 270. So that was the last thing probably we focused on, and we said this is the time when the madhahib emerged, the well-known madhahib, generally speaking, they emerged and they became popular, they were very well established. Afterwards, what happened, as we said, these madhahib of these scholars developed, started developing. The students of the students and the scholars of these madhahib started developing the fiqh. So it was written down by the students, sometimes by the originators of the madhahib themselves, like in the case of Imam Shafi'i specifically. But mainly it was written down by the students, which we call tadweenul fiqhi. And we mentioned that the development of hadith and the fact that hadith was documented, was put in, was in collections and masaneed, this also helped in the development of fiqh. The scholars afterwards, specifically the followers of the madhahib, they focused on what we can call tahrirul madhab in Arabic, which is basically developing the madhab and establishing it more scientifically, in a more systematic way. So you would see the scholars of these madhahib started writing down what we call mutun or matn, main texts. So you will have among these mutun usually short texts that summarize the madhab, and then you will have scholars who will explain these mutun, So we would say after the imams of the originators of the madhahib, there was what we call tadweenu al-madhab. Tadweenu al-madhab was basically when the students or the imam himself wrote down the fatawa, documented them, and had a collection of them. That's the tadween. Then the scholars moved into something that's basically what we can call, generally speaking, tahrir al-madhab. Tahrir al-madhab is to study the madhab, completely focus on this madhab, and start to develop texts out of this madhab. Short texts that we call matan, and then explanations, extended, elaborated explanations on these short texts, which we call hawashi or shuruh. Hawashi or shuruh. Okay? This is how, generally speaking, the madhahib went on. The scholars took the madhahib as frameworks to function within. So the Hanafi scholars who decided to follow the madhab of Abu Hanifa, they decided to work their fiqh within the framework of madhab Abi Hanifa, the principles that were established by Abu Hanifa and his main students, specifically Abu Yusuf al-Qadi, and to a great extent as well, Muhammad bin Hassan al-Shaybani. Then Imam Malik said, his fiqh was later on written down, and we have al-mudawwana in al-fiqh al-maliki, where the scholars of al-madhab al-maliki have written down the fatawa of Imam Malik. Then later on, the scholars of al-madhab al-maliki, they started writing down these short texts and then explaining them. The same thing happened with Imam Shafi'i, but Imam Shafi'i, we said he had the advantage of writing down his own madhab. So he wrote, he documented his own fiqh, specifically in his book Al-Umm. In his book Al-Umm. But later on, his students, specifically like Al-Muzani, he's one of his best students, he wrote his own book on fiqh. And then the scholars of the Shafi'i madhab started writing more books. Specifically, now the Shafi'is became very well known for writing what we call mutun, very short texts on the fiqh. And then they would explain them. One of the most famous books on fiqh al-Shafi'i, al-mutun, very famous, Matnu Abi Shuja'. Matnu Abi Shuja'. Until today, it's been used. Matnu Abi Shuja'. It's a very short, and if you read it, you won't even understand it. Even Arabs. They read it, they won't understand it. So this is why they needed what we call hawashi, or shuruh, explanations and commentaries on them. Imam Ahmad, we said, he disliked to write his own fatawa, so he would focus on hadith. But later on, his son and some of his students as well, they wrote down the masail al-Imam Ahmad. They tried to collect the fiqh and the questions that Imam Ahmad answered, collect them in these collections. So we have these big collections of masail al-Imam Ahmad. And then later on, the scholars developed their own books on the Hanbali madhab, and then developed the mutun. For example, one of the most famous, until today, one of the most famous mutun, or short texts on al-fiqh al-Hanbali, madhab al-Hanbali, is Zad al-Mustaqni'. Zad al-Mustaqni'. Also, if you read it, most likely you won't understand what it means. These very short texts were very difficult to understand. And this is what is mentioned, by the way, some like the some of those who wrote about the history of legislation, they consider this to be a decline. That people, instead of the scholars, instead of being concerned with the Quran, the Sunnah, and how the fiqh has taken from them or distilled from them, they actually focused on creating these very complicated, very short texts that are very difficult to understand, and make them the main books of fiqh. So this was considered by some to be a sign of decline. Although some scholars see this as tafannun. Tafannun, that means people are as an innovative approach. As an innovative approach, more of an like development in fiqh rather than a decline. So there's a debate there. The main decline came with what we call ta'assub, okay? A blind following of the madahib, which was accompanied by some sort of sectarianism, some cynicism, and bigotry among Muslims. So people would, even some of the followers of madahib, they said when al-Mahdi comes down, or when al-Masih, al-Mahdi come down, they would rule over people by our madhab. Like if we're Hanafi, by the Hanafi madhab. If we're Maliki, by the Maliki madhab. Or Shafi'i, by the Shafi'i madhab. We mentioned previously as well, there were some big debates that led sometimes to even fights, physical fighting among followers of the madhahib. And we said that some of them would not even marry from the other madhahib. All of this, as we said, this is part of the decline. And unfortunately, some scholars as well were involved in this. But there were still scholars from all the madhahib who would not succumb to that level, who would still hold on to following the Quran and the Sunnah, and who would still perform ijtihad within the madhab. And even though if they differed with other madhab, they would not look down upon the others. They would consider this to be an issue of ikhtilaf, multiple perspectives on the same thing, and they would respect this. So this was the case on and off throughout the time from 270 until our time. So this kind of sectarianism and partisanship would grow, and then it would fade away. So it would, you know, take cycles. Sometimes it would be up, sometimes it would go down, and so on and so forth. Alhamdulillah, we are living at a time when it has actually faded away to a great extent. Talking about 60 years ago, in Mecca, in Al-Haram, and it was also in Al-Azhar, was also in Al-Jami' Al-Umawi in Damascus, there were four maharib, four places to pray, four jama'ahs. So Adhan al-Dhuhr would go on in Damascus in Al-Jami' Al-Umawi, the Shafi'is would start their salah and the Hanafis would be sitting back, because Syria is mainly Shafi'i and Hanafi. So the Shafi'is would start their prayer and the Hanafis would be sitting at the back of the masjid observing them. They have nothing to do with them. So the Shafi'is would finish their jama'ah and they would leave the masjid. Then the Hanafi imam would come and they would make an iqamah and the Hanafis would pray together. That wasn't only in Dimashq or Masjid al-Umawi, that was in Al-Haram, in Mecca. Four jama'ahs. So the Hanbalis would pray first, then probably the Shafi'is, then the Hanafis, and then the Malikis. Each one has their own jama'ah. And you are there, if you are a follower of the Maliki madhab, for example, and it's the Shafi'i jama'ah, you sit and you don't join them, you just look at them. Or you engage in a conversation. So alhamdulillah, at our times, we don't have this. We don't have this. So this is such a good thing. There's one sign of, and I won't mention the madhahib, just because sometimes these get very sensitive. In some of the books of fiqh, like they would include the sectarianism even when they're talking about fiqh. So, for example, there was an issue of if there's a dead animal, and it's in a public place like a main street, and it smells, what should we do with it? So some said you would bury it, some said you would burn it. Some of the scholars in that madhab said you would burn it, some said you would throw it somewhere else, and so on and so forth. Now one of the scholars, he said, no, we throw it to a Shafi'i so he could eat it. And that's mentioned in a book of fiqh, okay? So this is what we call this kind of ta'assub that was part of the decline. That was part of the decline. You would find a lot. Sometimes you'd find in some of the madahib, not the madahib, I would say some of the scholars who fell into this ta'assub, they would actually say, like the Malikis, they would be the last ones to enter paradise on the Day of Judgment. Our madhab would be the first. That's what they said. So these things are there. So this kind of sectarianism, that was part of the decline. That was part of the decline. Now let's look at the bright side of the development of fiqh. So what I said, there was a decline, but it wasn't that gloomy. It wasn't that gloomy. You would have moments and times or periods of revival and advancement in fiqh. For example, you have something appeared, what we can call al-mawsu'at al-fiqhiyya, encyclopedias of fiqh. Encyclopedias of fiqh that appeared at certain times. The scholars really praise the book of Al-Muhalla by Imam Ibn Hazm. Although Imam Ibn Hazm, he refused the madhahib and he made it obligatory on every Muslim to make ijtihad. Every Muslim, even an illiterate person, he has to make ijtihad for him. But he was a very intelligent man. He doesn't mean, okay, you pick up the Quran, make ijtihad. No, he says, your ijtihad is who to follow. But you have to work to getting yourself off the ground where you can actually reach a point where you can make ijtihad yourself from the Quran and the Sunnah. And he goes to the point where he says even ijtihad is haram. Taqleed is haram. And it's only allowed out of darura, out of necessity. Out of necessity. But Imam Ibn Hazm wrote a book that all the scholars respect. And it's called Al-Muhalla. It's called Al-Muhalla. Where it's really a fiqh encyclopedia. So he deals with issues of fiqh. It's very well organized as well. And he takes the rulings from the Quran, the Sunnah. He shows you exactly how he takes the rulings. So this is why it's very helpful. Any faqih actually should study Al-Muhalla by Ibn Hazm. And he would bring the opinions of other madhahib. And he would criticize them sometimes harshly. sometimes very harshly. Another book that's considered to be more of an encyclopedia as well was Al-Mughni by Ibn Qudama. Al-Mughni by Ibn Qudama. Al-Mughni is really an encyclopedia. And although Ibn Qudama is a Hanbali, but this is why we call this such books encyclopedias, because they don't only include the madhab, they include the other madhab as well. So Al-Mughni, or Ibn Qudama in Al-Mughni, he would take the rulings from the Quran, the Sunnah, show you exactly how to deal with the texts, and then he would mention the other madhahib, and he would discuss with them how they took the rulings from the Quran and Sunnah, and he would argue against them, or sometimes for them. So you would actually, by studying Al-Mughni, you would be studying not only the Hanbali madhahib, you would be studying more or less the four madhahib, the four madhahib. Another book that that's at such a high standing is Al-Majmu' Sharh Al-Muhadhab. Al-Majmu' by Al-Nawawi, Imam Al-Nawawi. It's another encyclopedia as well. Imam Al-Nawawi is very strong as well in what we call istinbat, when he takes the rulings from the Quran and the Sunnah, the way he deals with that. So this book of Al-Muhalla is actually a very important book. It's considered to be an encyclopedia. But Imam Al-Nawawi passed away before completing it, before finishing it. And at the beginning he was very elaborate, but then he decided to take it a little bit, like he wasn't more like elaborate as he was at the beginning. So he decided to take a shorter approach to things, not mention everything. So this was a very bright thing during the history of fiqh. Recently in our times, in the last 100 years, a few encyclopedias appeared. First, in Damascus, there was Al-Mawsu' Al-Fiqhiyya that started in Damascus. And it was Sheikh Mustafa Al-Zarqa. Sheikh Mustafa Al-Zarqa who started this effort in the University of Damascus, Jami' al-Dimashq. Was also supported by the Awqaf in Syria at the time. That was in the early 50s. It really began very well, but unfortunately was not completed. So a few volumes and then, or a couple of volumes, and they started with Tahara, and I don't think they finished later on. But it was a very good project. Then Al-Azhar decided actually to do their own, in Egypt, to do the encyclopedia. And they started, but they didn't also finish. But then the effort was taken up by Kuwait. So we have Al-Mawsu' Al-Fiqhiyya. Al-Mawsu' Al-Fiqhiyya. And also they actually enlisted the help of Sheikh Mustafa Al-Zarqa. Sheikh Mustafa Al-Zarqa was one of the great fuqaha of our times. So, and he was usuli, one of actually the best usuli in terms of usul al-fiqh. And probably that was the most successful mawsu'ah. So you actually have it here in the library. You can see it, it's the blue. I think it's around 41 volumes. 41 volumes now. I'm not sure if it's complete, but it's an excellent work. It's written, easily written, very easy language, accessible, and brings the opinions of the different four madhahib as well. So it makes fiqh accessible. This is what these modern encyclopedias are about. So this probably was the most successful encyclopedia, Al-Mawsu' Al-Fiqhiyya, which is printed in Al-Kuwait, developed by the Wazarat Al-Awqaf, the Awqaf Ministry in Kuwait. And as I said, you have it there. You also, I think in that library you can see, it's good to check these books, just have a look at them. I think you have Al-Mughni, a copy of Al-Mughni there, and you have Al-Muhalla as well. Al-Majmu' is not there, I haven't seen it. But Ibn Hajar is probably you're talking probably the explanation of Sahih Bukhari, but that's, we're trying just to see the books that relate to our course. Okay, so that was, these were the encyclopedias. The development of Al-Qawa'id Al-Fiqhiyya, that's another important bright aspect of fiqh during this period of time. Not the modern, but as I said, from 270 onwards. The development of Al-Qawa'id Al-Fiqhiyya, that was a very beautiful an important development in fiqh. Al-qawa'id al-fiqhiyya are principles that you would find in the Qur'an and the Sunnah mainly, sometimes stated clearly. Like the Prophet ﷺ says, لَا ضَرَرَ وَلَا ضِرَارَ. Harm should not be inflicted nor reciprocated. Okay, so you should not harm other people, and other people should not harm you. So harm should be eliminated. So this is taken as one of the main fiqhi maxims, which we might be, next course might be actually talking about this. So it was written like la darar wa la dirar, or sometimes it was given an alternative kind of wording like ad-dararu yuzal, ad-dararu yuzal. Whatever harm, it should be eliminated. It should be eliminated. So you would find this, the beauty and the power of the fiqhi maxims or al-qawa'id al-fiqhiyya, is that they apply to countless cases. You look at everything, even like qisas, like the hudud in Islam, the punishments in Islam. Why do you think they are actually legislated? In order to remove harm. Because when there is murder, when there is punishment, there is less. It's less likely to be like to, for people to commit crimes. When there is punishment for theft, people are less likely to commit crimes or to commit theft. So the reason, and this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَكُمْ فِي الْقَصَاصِ أو فِي الْقَصَاصِ حَيَاتٌ يَا أُولِي الْأَلْبَابِ. Or people of understanding, in qasas, in these punishments, there is life for you. Why? Because harm would be taken away by this kind, because they are a deterrent factor. A deterrent factor. So everywhere you look at Islam, you will see the rulings actually clearly, you will find this element that harm is taken away by these rulings. A main theme in almost everything in Islam, that harm is taken away. This serves the fuqaha when they deal with a new issue and they don't know exactly, you know, which ruling to apply to it or which principle does it fall under. Sometimes the fiqhi rulings are the tipping point or the factor that really makes them find a decision or come arrive at a decision about this. So if there's an issue that's contested and it seems to be a very fair debate on both sides, bringing for example this qa'ida or this maxim, al-darr yuzal. So you would see where is more harm and when is the harm removed, and okay, this ruling would be leaning towards that side. Okay? So some of the qawa'id are very general, some of them are very specific. Like one of the very specific maxims or rules, كُلُّ قَرْضٍ جَرَّ مَنْفَعَةً فَهُوَ رِبَا. Every loan that brings about a benefit to the lender, this benefit is riba. It's general but yet specific to a specific area. So for example, I give you a loan and once I gave you the loan, you keep giving me gifts. Or you do some kind of business, so you give me some exemptions. Right? You give me some exemptions. So these exemptions, these gifts that I'm given by you because I lent you money, that's considered to be, by the fuqaha, riba. That's considered to be riba. Until you pay me back, we're even, then you want to give me gifts, that's fine, that's not riba. So this is very important. This is very important. So this would help solve a lot of issues, a lot of problems. Okay, I borrowed money from so-and-so. I'm going to do, for example, I work as a plumber. Can I work for him and give him maybe a discount, a bigger discount? Or I'm selling some stuff, maybe I'll give him a very special price. Why are you giving him a special price just because he lent you the money? Because that's going to affect the relationship. That's going to affect the relationship, okay? So that's a rule that the scholars have found out. How did they find out? By looking at so many things, rulings in Islam, they all seem to be pointing to this. So they decided to materialize it and word it within a very clear structure, and they put it in exact wordings so everyone can see it. Instead of it being known only to the scholars who have studied the Sharia, no, now we make it available so everyone can see it, so we put it in an exact wording where everyone has access to it, So it becomes a reference point. These are al-qawa'id al-fiqhiyya. The Hanafi scholars have really excelled from an early stage with al-qawa'id al-fiqhiyya. A lot of their fiqh is actually based on qawa'id. So this was a very good development. The documentation, proper documentation and encyclopedias on al-qawa'id al-fiqhiyya started only recently. 35 years ago. So they started to take a very good place within fiqh in the last 30 years. Prior to that, they were mainly the work of individual scholars based on their own, you know, research and so on and so forth. But now they've become more documented, more like accessible to everyone, more canonized, so to speak. Another development we said was al-maqasid, the development of al-maqasid, which are the objectives of Sharia. Al-maqasid were a very good development. As I said, they were always there behind the scenes, but the first imam to really bring them and materialize them and put them in a very clear structured framework was al-imam Abu Ishaq al-Shatibi from al-Andalus in his book al-Muwafaqat. Al-Muwafaqat, and a little bit in al-I'tisam, but mainly in al-Muwafaqat. And he basically said, Islam came to make life better by taking care of things at three levels. Necessities, al-daruriyat, necessities. These are things, if they are jeopardized or they are violated, life becomes almost unbearable. And these are the religion, okay, hifduddin. So Islam was sent, you find everything in Islam is actually pointing towards preserving the religion, which means the religion of truth. Your right to know Allah and to follow the guidance of Allah and to secure your place in paradise. So everyone has the right to this. So Islam came to preserve this. Second, life, preserve life. Al-Hayah, or nafs. And third, al-aql, sanity, your reason, your ability to think. So this is why alcohol, drugs, anything that intoxicates you is haram, because it takes away your mind, takes away your consciousness. Al-ird aw nasab, your honor and dignity, and your right to know your parents. Your right to know your parents and to know where you came from. So the scholars, sometimes they say al-ird, which is honor and dignity, and sometimes they say it's a nasab. It's actually both are strongly related. So we said hifdhu al-deen, hifdhu al-nafs, hifdhu al-aql, hifdhu al-ird, okay, and al-man. Possessions and property. So everything in Islam came to preserve these five. These are the number one. They cannot be jeopardized. And this is why when any of the instructions in Islam put any of those at jeopardy, it's compromised. For example, eating pork is haram in Islam. But if you are in a state where your life is on the line because there's nothing to eat and you're starving to death, there's only pork, here you can eat it. Haram or halal is compromised here because now one of the main necessities is at jeopardy. The second level is al-hajiyat. Al-hajiyat are the things in life that we need or we need to get or we need to repel and get rid of, that if they are not observed, life becomes very uncomfortable. Like al-hajiyat, for example, the scholars say having a house to live in. Having a place to live in. Eating food, what's beyond the basic necessity? Like, in order to survive, if you eat just bread and water, you'd live, right? That's necessity. But let's say, for example, eating meat and chicken every other day. Eating fruits, different types of food. Okay? Wearing nice, respectable clothes. Necessity for clothing, for example, which is preserving the self, okay, is you wear what protects you from cold, for example. But it might be really ugly, might be big size, it doesn't really look nice. But the fact that it fits you and it looks nice and it feels comfortable, besides protecting you, protecting your body, that's the second level, hajiyat. Hajiyat, the needs. Needs, general needs. That if they are violated, life becomes very uncomfortable. Very uncomfortable. So you can survive and you can live all your life without them, right? But life would be extremely hard. And then the third level, which is less, and that's at-tahsiniyat, the things that improve the quality of life. More of luxuries. More of luxuries. So having cornflakes for morning, in the morning, right? Having your French vanilla probably, or a cup of coffee. Yeah, something like this. These are tahsiniyat, things that improve the quality of life. Having, you know, buying leather couches. It's tahsiniyat, improve the life. Perfumes, wearing perfumes. It's not a necessity. It's not a very strong need. Okay? But it's tahsin, it improves the quality of life, of your experience in life. So these are tahsiniyat. So Islam does provide. But first and foremost, we have to provide for the necessities. And then if these are taken care of, the importance now shifts to the strong needs, hajiyat. If these are taken care of, then people are allowed to look more into at-tahsiniyat. Okay, things that beautify and make life more luxurious. That's a very basic explanation. There are dynamics for how these three levels interact, okay? And they have an impact on a lot of the rulings. And they're very important, by the way, for our times, subhanAllah. So we said al-qawa'id al-fiqhiyya, the fiqhi maxims, and maqasid al-shari'a, science of the objectives of sharia, were great developments, and they led to a lot more systemization. Usul al-fiqh also developed greatly. Usul al-fiqh developed greatly during this period. So we said it started with Imam al-Shafi'i mainly in his book al-Risala. But then afterwards, it really developed. So it became a specialization in its own self, by its own self. It had its own merit, its own position. And the scholars were called usuli, like someone who specialized in usul al-fiqh. And some great, really, like books have emerged, great names have appeared. Probably among the most notable, I could be having my own bias because probably studying Usul Fiqh from, generally there are two main trends in Usul Fiqh, There's the Hanafi, that's has its own root, and there is the Jumhur, the other three Madhahab. The other three Madhahab have more similarity within themselves than the Hanafi has with them. So the Hanafi, there is a lot in common, but still, like the Hanafi school and Usul Fiqh was a bit more distinct. The other three Madhahab were more close to each other in terms of Usul. So the terminology is pretty much the same, definitions are the same, a lot of the issues in Usul Fiqh that they study are pretty much the same. Obviously they disagree about certain things among themselves, but still, like, whereas the Hanafis, they have, even the terminology sometimes is different. The terminology is sometimes different, so they have developed their own terminology. So maybe I'm coming from the Jumhur perspective with Usul Fiqh, so I might be reflecting my own bias as well there. That the most notable scholars of Usul Fiqh, to me as far as I saw, were a lot of them came from the, especially the ones who made a big difference in Usul, they come from a Shafi'i mainly, and second from a Maliki background. So you have in Shafi'i madhab, mainly you have Imam al-Haramain al-Juwayni. He wrote the famous metin or text on Usul al-Fiqh, which is al-Waraqat. And he also has al-Burhan in Usul al-Fiqh, which is one of the main books in Usul al-Fiqh. So he was a big thing in Usul al-Fiqh. Al-Razi, who wrote al-Mahsul, one of the main books in Usul al-Fiqh. And you also have Imam al-Ghazali, who wrote al-Mustasfa. And you have also al-Baydawi, these are scholars, Shafi'i scholars, main scholars of Usul al-Fiqh. In al-Maliki, you have al-Imam al-Qarafi. As far as I believe, he's Maliki. I hope I'm not mistaken. Subhanallah. I think he's Maliki, yes. And you have al-Imam al-Shatibi himself. Yes. Okay, so Usul al-Fiqh developed into very distinct science and its own, you know, fields of study within Usul al-Fiqh itself, and it really became a very well-defined science, explaining the background of Fiqh, what are the dynamics in the back end of Fiqh, that are working in the back end of Fiqh. So it developed, and it's really a very powerful science, and it sharpens your mind. It does sharpen your mind. Any student of knowledge, the moment they study Usul al-Fiqh and reach a good level in it, this is a turning point in their life. It takes your intellectual abilities to a completely different level. It's a very powerful tool. Usul al-Fiqh is a very powerful tool. And it gives you a very strong perspective on al-fiqh and the differences, why the scholars differ. And you can see, once you're standing on the grounds of usul al-fiqh, you understand that this difference can be resolved and there are differences that cannot be resolved. And you can see why. And you can tell. So you'll find someone saying, oh, this issue, we have to resolve it between the madhab, we have to get all together. But coming from an usuli perspective, you can see there's no way you can get people to agree on this. There's no way you can. Why? Because the difference is in the usul, in the very principles. So it's not a matter of, oh, he's taking this text or he's ignoring this text. It's not like this. Okay? So usul al-fiqh has developed greatly, mashallah. But there was, after saying, roughly speaking, and there is, by the way, Imam al-Zarkashi, who's Shafi'i. And Imam Badr al-Din al-Zarkashi, one of the main scholars of usul al-fiqh, he wrote an encyclopedia. It's called Al-Bahru Al-Muhit, the encompassing, all-encompassing ocean on Usul al-Fiqh. And he pretty hasn't left anything of Usul al-Fiqh except that he put it in that book. And the book, I think, is six volumes. And I believe you can actually find it even there. I think you can find it there. If I'm not mistaken, yes, it should be there. Yeah, so so the scholars after these main scholars, usually usul al-fiqh became more repetitive. So you would study some books and then study other books. Like, and this was a point of frustration for me at some stage. I was really very interested in usul al-fiqh, so I started going into the main books, read them, studied them, studied with some of the scholars. Then I started getting more books. So all the new books that I'm buying, as I read through them, I read this before. Even the examples are the same. So there's a lot of repetition, and to the letter, sometimes 10 pages, just copy-paste. So there was less renewal in Usul al-Fiqh, let's say from around 600 until our times. There's less, you know, nothing really so much new, with very few exceptions. Some of the people or the personalities that really made a difference throughout the history in terms of fiqh, we mentioned was Ibn Taymiyyah, after the four imams, okay, after the four imams, Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah. And he really made a big difference in terms of his work was more about integration, synthesis. He's a person, he's an encyclopedic person. He studied all of the madhab. He studied all of the madhab and he knew them very well. He knew them very well. And he extensively studied all of them. So he mastered them and he synthesized them. And he was very knowledgeable of the Quran and the Sunnah and very knowledgeable of the old madhab as well, specifically of these companions and the tabi'een. So Ibn Taymiyyah somehow brought a new flavor to an approach to fiqh by bringing it back to its origins, which is the Quran, the Sunnah, the fatawa of the companions and of the tabi'een, without compromising the contributions of the scholars of the madhab. That was the unique approach of Ibn Taymiyyah. So he would not look down upon the contributions of the scholars of the four madhahib. On the contrary, oftentimes he would benefit from them a lot. And he would sometimes argue, make a case against them. And sometimes he would lean with this madhahib. So he comes from a Hanbali background. But sometimes he would take the opinion of the Hanafis after discussions. And sometimes he would take the Shafi'i madhahib. And he would, so he was a mujtahid mutlaq. The highest level of ijtihad, someone who's got all the tools to be able to make ijtihad. So that was a very important landmark when it comes to Ibn Taymiyyah, that he brought about a synthesis. So even though he would argue sometimes against some of the issues that are there in the madhahib, he would not look down upon them, he would not neglect them. On the contrary, he learned a lot and he would approve of, and he would appreciate, and he would praise these madhahib and the scholars of these madhahib for their contributions. Ibn Taymiyyah's understanding of usul al-fiqh was very profound. And although the maqasid of sharia were written after Ibn Taymiyyah, Imam al-Shatibi became after Ibn Taymiyyah. Not that much even, like, I think in his early years, Ibn Taymiyyah was still alive. But al-Shatibi was in Andalus, Ibn Taymiyyah was in al-Sham and in Egypt sometimes. So such a long distance. And we have to know about Ibn Taymiyyah, during his life, his books were banned. After his death, his books were banned as well. And his fatawa appeared later on. So it's Ibn Taymiyyah still, a lot of the maqasid of sharia, you will find them scattered around his book. And like one of my teachers, Sheikh Mashhur, he's the one who brought, who made the tahqiq, verification, and like the book of Al-Muwafaqat by Shatibi, he's the one who took very good care of it and chased the different transcripts, and he brought the full text of it and made it available with a lot of notes and explanations. So it's the best copy so far. And I think he did that 20 years ago. So he says, I can see a lot of influence from Ibn Taymiyyah on al-Shatibi. Sometimes there are statements that are obviously taken from Ibn Taymiyyah. Very clear. So the influence is seen there. So Ibn Taymiyyah was such a big influence. Imam al-Shatibi, through his book specifically, Al-Muwafaqat on the Maqasid of Sharia, was such a great influence as well in terms of usul. There could be other scholars here and there, but as I said, I'm still speaking from my perspective. I can see that Ibn Taymiyyah is probably the main, personality that really broke that kind of decline when it came to the history of fiqh. So he was a very unique landmark in the development of fiqh. As a person. Now let's come to our present time. That doesn't mean they were not great scholars. They were great scholars. But what I'm talking about in terms of developing the fiqh and the legislation and the approach to fiqh. Okay? But there were great scholars within all the four madhahib, but still they were working within the frameworks of their madhahib, and they did not necessarily bring such a huge development to the history of fiqh. In our times, some developments are very interesting. First, what we call al-majami' al-fiqhiyya, the assemblies of scholars. Some scholars today would like to call this al-ijtihad al-jama'i, which is group ijtihad. So instead of one scholar making ijtihad, no, a group of scholars would come together and make an ijtihad about an issue. That's unique. That's unique. So we have al-majma' al-fiqhi fi Jeddah. In Jeddah, that was probably was the first one to be established. And then we have other majama' in different countries. In Al-Azhar, there's majma' fiqhi in Egypt. And there is al-majma' al-Urubi al-Ifta', which is the assembly of Ifta' for Europe, headed by Dr. Yusuf al-Qardawi. And there is the assembly of North American jurists, which is, I believe, AMJA, right? Called AMJA. AMJA, A-M-J-A, headed by Dr. Salah al-Sawi. So these are assemblies of where the scholars come together, try to make ijtihad collectively as a group. There are some personalities that appeared and really brought some kind of revival, powerful revival. And I would say one of the biggest influences was Sheikh Muhammad Nasiruddin al-Albani. He was such a big influence. In the sense, he revived Madhab Ahl al-Hadith, which is the approach to the Quran of the Sunnah based on the understanding of the companions and the Tabi'een. And although Sheikh Albani does not disregard the madhahib, on the contrary, and when you read his fiqh, he consults a lot from the madhahib, because he himself grew within the Hanafi madhab. He himself grew within a Hanafi background. And then later on, when he was asked what's the best way to study fiqh, he said the best way to study fiqh is to study within a madhab. And then after you master the tools and you reach a high level of knowledge, then you can, after you have gain these tools, now you can break from the madhab when you see a strong point that where the madhab is not in line with what you believe is the truth. Slowly, but he says the best way to master fiqh is to study it within a madhab. And he was asked, what do you personally recommend? Which madhab gives you the best tools and probably like builds your, what we call al-malak al-fiqhiyya, your fiqhi skills and abilities? He recommended the madhab al-Shafi'i. But sometimes some of the people who ascribe to Sheikh Albani or follow Sheikh Albani, you find them completely disregarding the madhab in a very negative sense. But anyone who really understands like the fiqh of Sheikh Albani, he sees that Sheikh Albani never disregarded the madhab. Maybe some of his statements were misinterpreted. Some of his followers did not really, properly, take his approach. So that led to some kind of impression that he was against the madhab. But he was against the ta'assub. He was against this sectarianism and the blind following of the madhahib as opposed to something that is clear in the Quran or the Sunnah. Influences, I'm talking specifically about fiqh. So I'm just trying to see, the influences. So Sheikh Al-Albani revived the importance of the texts when it came to the hadith. Because at some stage, a lot of the study, the studies of fiqh were based on the mutun. And if you study these mutun or these texts, fiqhi texts, they don't have any Quran or Sunnah. As we said, they are meant more of as an innovative approach. But there's no Quran and Sunnah. So sometimes people will study fiqh for years without really consulting the Quran and the Sunnah. The evidence might come later, but they would study the words of the scholars. So Sheikh Al-Albani was pretty much against this. And he revived an approach that is heavily based on the Quran and the Sunnah and the statements of the early generations in that sense. So this is why some people took him to be opposing the madhahib, but he actually wasn't. So his influence when it comes to fiqh, because he obviously his main specialty is hadith, is that he brought this into the fiqh. He brought it back. It's always been, but at some stage, in like its importance was watered down. But Sheikh Al-Bani brought that back again, emphasized it heavily. And his influence is witnessed everywhere, almost everywhere. I see some of the people who really had such an influence and some kind of acceptance as well. And although I know some people would disagree with this, is Sheikh Yusuf Al-Qaradawi. Sheikh Yusuf Al-Qaradawi had such a big influence. The fact that a lot of his fatawa are taken seriously. And in terms of making ijtihad about things, you know, at our time, when his fatawa as well was challenged by a lot of the scholars. So whether you agree with him or I agree with him or not, that's irrelevant. But what I'm talking about, the influence. And so you see, he's been, as I said, and since he heads for a long time, he headed the assembly of scholars in different countries and in Europe as well. He had such a big influence. So his fatawa were widely accepted, widely adopted by so many people, and even some of the scholars who opposed him like 30, 20 years ago, some of them are actually taking his fatwa today. They're actually making the same fatwa today. And as I said, regardless of whether you or I agree with him or disagree with him, that's completely irrelevant. I'm just saying about what seems to be the influence. Now, what is the state of fiqh today? Ta'assub has been less. It has some bursts here and there in certain pockets, and sometimes it comes out, takes a vicious kind of face. But alhamdulillah, speaking of our times, probably because the Muslim Ummah has been challenged a lot. So the Muslims, there's a sense of unity that we're all in the same plight. And also Muslims being displaced a lot, having also with means of communication and transport being easier. There's a lot of communication. And also Muslim minorities living in other countries. And the scholars paying a lot of attention to Muslim minorities as well. This has sort of diluted the borders between the madhahib and has brought people together, which is a very good influence. It's a very good influence. Yet there is a state of, collectively speaking, there is a state of indecisiveness when it comes to a lot of issues, new issues. So you'll find the scholars very hesitant to give a ruling about new issues. Sometimes scholars would give very precautious fatawa about new issues. And then later on, these things would change. These things would change. So there is a lot of precaution. So this is why there's indecisiveness, generally speaking. And a lot of the... And I personally think that the connection between the scholars and the general masses has been weakened. In the sense, there's a lot of public personalities who talk about issues of Islam without these people having the proper training. So you have a lot of Muslim speakers today. They don't have the proper training in fiqh, in aqeedah, in usul fiqh, in all of these tools. And they are speaking. And they have wide audiences. Wide audiences. The internet, social media has contributed greatly to this. So you have a lot of personalities. This has taken people away from the scholars. People who seem to be more talkative, people are following them. Although the scholars sometimes, there are issues where the scholars decide to remain silent. Not because they don't have an answer, but because they know it's wiser to be silent now. People don't appreciate, people want someone to give them an answer, regardless. Just give me an answer. Give me an answer. But these issues are sometimes follow from the verse where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تَسْأَلُوا عَنْ أَشْيَاءَ إِن تُبْدَ لَكُمْ تَسُؤْكُمْ. Oh, you who believe, don't ask about things. That when they are revealed to you and shown to you, they would actually cause you harm and discomfort and maybe, you know, other negative, you know, impact, another negative impact. So the connection between the scholars don't feel that they are so much welcome by the masses. They don't feel that they are that much trusted, that they are so much heard among the masses. So they are very careful with their approach. And that's true. An example, when the revolution took place in Egypt, some scholars spoke and they changed their previous positions. And that was a reason for them to be really tried. And I would take one example, Sheikh Abu Ishaq al-Huwaini. He remained silent. He remained silent. Later on, a couple of years later, he said that he did not like that. He did not like the situation, people rebelling. He said he wasn't comfortable about that. He wasn't comfortable about this. So he said, and I couldn't speak because of people were completely out of their minds. People were not willing to listen to anyone who would say no. And it would be a big trial for him. And he didn't want to lose the people, so he realized that his silence was better than speaking at that time, because he thought he might be in a position to advise people when that hype fades away. So that's just one example, one contemporary example. Some scholars were speaking from other countries that this was not right. This was not the right approach to deal with these kind of rulers. This was not the right way. These people were labeled as sold out, as agents, as so on and so forth, right? So there was a lot of confusion. So the scholars are no longer occupying the high position they usually occupied. And another reason that contributed to this was the scholars were usually respected by the government. But these days, the scholars are not really given their position by the government. The only ones who are given their position by the government are the ones who are pro-government. And obviously, there are exceptions. There are exceptions. So, like, looking at the state of Egypt today, you recognize what's happening with the scholars, right? So who are the scholars that are brought to the forefront, who are given the positions, who are given the platform? And the scholars who are not in line with the government policies, these people are pushed to the side. So this also contributed, since most of the governments do not hold the scholars in high esteem, people don't respect the scholars that much. Or people don't even know who the scholars are, who the right scholars are. So these also contributed to this kind of disconnect. As I said, also the media has contributed, in the sense there are a lot of speakers, loudspeakers, who talk about religion without any training. And some of these people might even be either non-Muslims who pretend to be Muslims, or these are people who are serving other agenda. So you have great figures, like some of the very common, like people who got some popularity, but now alhamdulillah is fading away, a person called Adnan Ibrahim. Anand Ibrahim is someone who studied, I don't know really what he studied, I think he's in Switzerland or in Austria. And he started making some statements about things that are happening, and so he gained so much popularity. But when you look at this person, listen to him, he doesn't have, he cites books and so on and so forth. You know, having access to books doesn't really, even if these are difficult books, it's not what you find in the books. It's the collective understanding. When you have a collective understanding, because everything is part of a context, when you don't have this collective and deep understanding of the heritage of the Muslims, of the Quran and the Sunnah, you can't just pick up a book and say, oh, this is what he says and this is how it applies to our times. You don't know, you don't understand the context. So this is one example. So that's the issue. The differences have, as well, sometimes pushed people away from listening to others. So you have such a big divide between people who follow the scholars that ascribe to what we call Salafiyya, and you have people on the other side who ascribe to probably other schools like Sufism, or sometimes intellectualism. So there's such a huge divide. Although in terms of aqeedah, this divide, from my perspective, is justified. But in terms of fiqh, you will find a lot of the fiqh issues are actually do not reach that level. Do not really reach that level. But once you disconnect yourself from that person completely, everything he says is wrong. But if anyone who's been reading and looking into fiqh over the last 30 years, you will find trends changing. So there was a huge divide. Yes, your fiqh is there, our fiqh is here. That's it. But now a lot of the fatawa are actually, you know, bridging. A lot of the fatawa are bridging and so on and so forth. But is there a very specific trend? I personally don't see a specific trend. At least I can't see a specific trend. There is not enough authority that is given to the scholars. So people are, and there is not so much agreement and unity among the scholars. So there is a state of confusion. There is a state of confusion now. The issue of fatwa shopping is very common. Fatwa shopping is very common these days. So a person would jump from one fatwa to the other based on what they desire. Based on what they desire. I have to say that Sheikh Al-Albani gave a lot of influence. And that's not only Sheikh Al-Albani, but it's also backed by what you can call the scholars in Saudi Arabia specifically, Sheikh Ibn Baz, rahimahullah, Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen. They popularized a pretty much identical school of thought in terms of focusing on the Quran, the Sunnah, and the fatawa of the companions, the Tabi'een, and the early generations. So there's a lot of focus, and this gained a lot of popularity among the masses. This gained a lot of popularity, and I think it had such a positive impact. I think it has. Although some people, as I said, misused it, a lot of people misused it in the sense they started talking ill about some of the scholars from the madhahib, or some of the contributions of the scholars of the madhahib. But if you look carefully into the fatawa of these three scholars, you will find a lot of respect for what the scholars have produced within other frameworks. So they had this. Even scholars from, like, sometimes a Sufi background, but in terms of fiqh, they have great contributions. You will find these scholars acknowledging this. And they would be recognizing this, and there would be sometimes their fatawa would be online with this. Okay? So sometimes these scholars have been misunderstood. And this kind of misunderstanding led to sometimes pushing the divide greater within certain circles. But you will find, as I said, in recent years, there's some kind of bridging that is taking place in terms of fiqh. There is some kind of bridging. But is there a definitive kind of pattern as to where fiqh is going? I personally can't see. Maybe there are patterns. Maybe. But I personally cannot see. The emergence of groups like ISIS, and Jabhat al-Nusra, and Al-Qaeda, and so on and so forth, and the fact that these are gaining sometimes some popularity among Muslims is actually problematic, and it shows that the scholars, the well-respected scholars, like when they are taken away from positions of authority and they're not the main reference point for the masses to learn from, the masses can get lost, can lose their way, and start being deluded by such extreme groups. The political trauma that Muslims have been through from the days of colonialism, then to the loss of Palestine, the occupation in Palestine, and now in recent years what's happening, specifically in Iraq, Syria, Muslims are living in such hard times, and this is having an impact on them. This is having an impact on the Muslims, unfortunately, in terms of even fiqh. So the divide as well, people are not listening to the scholars as they should. And probably there is, the scholars probably need to take a stronger stance when it comes to these, but I personally subscribe to the position that the scholars know what they're doing. They're human beings, their assessment of the situation could be sometimes wrong, but when they decide not to talk, not to speak, I think they have a point there. I do think they have a point there. Because our times are very troublesome times, and making a statement sometimes, even if it's true, might cause more harm. And we, generally, as general people, general Muslims, might not be able to foresee what these scholars are able to capture with their wisdom. Generally speaking. So to me, the state of fiqh, generally speaking, yes, academically, it's excellent. Academically, it's excellent. There's a lot of dissertations, academic studies. There's a lot of development. But in terms of the impact fiqh is having on the masses, this is not up to the desired level. So to me, it's a bit confusing. It's a bit confusing. I hope Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will, inshallah, will bring more goodness about. Okay, sure. So these are my notes. Sure. Yeah. Any questions? Comments? Anyone can see a pattern? Anyone can see a pattern? Fiqh, the development of fiqh at our times. What is happening? What is happening? Academically, I can say for sure, there is a lot of development. Amazing development. There is. But in terms of the impact fiqh has, and is this, because this is mainly micro. This is micro, you know, development. It's all in the details, in the small stuff. But there is no major mega trend that is overtaking fiqh and taking it in a completely new direction. And it's not a huge development. Like when you say Imam al-Shafi'i, he bridged such a huge divide, as you noticed, between Madrasat al-Ra'i and Madrasat al-Hadith. He bridged that in such a powerful way that brought a profound approach. Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal made very good use of Tadween al-Hadith, the availability of Hadith when it was collected. He made a very profound use to create a madhab that is very strongly based on the Sunnah. Ibn Taymiyyah integrated a lot of these schools and so on and so forth. So Abu Hanifa previously bringing the science or the knowledge of the fiqh of the people of Iraq all together in such a very applicable form and such systematic school of thought, that was profound. Imam Malik to get the knowledge of the companions and the children and the grandchildren of the companions, put it within one madhab and make it based on one book of hadith, that's very profound as well. So no major trends seem to be taking place at this stage. That's within the academia. That's the issue. Yeah.
So the pattern that I noticed is that the usul of fiqh hasn't changed. What's happening is the lifestyle and the trend of society is changing. So for example, for years, in the Islamic world, you had a khalifa and you had, you know, rules governing the Islamic world under the Khalifa, and the Khalifa disappeared. Now you have Muslim rulers and you have Muslim people, but nothing governing the Muslim people. You just have a Muslim government, but it's not a Khalifa, right?
Yeah.
So you have that trend that's changed, but the rules haven't changed in Usul al-Fiqh. So again, you have scholars trying to apply the Usul and the rules.
But there's something about Usul al-Fiqh here. Usul al-Fiqh doesn't change by time. It doesn't change. There's no need for it to change. It tells you how to handle the text. When there is a command, what does it mean? Obligation or recommendation, for example. When something is mentioned in two different texts. In one text it's general, one text is specific. How should we take it, general or specific? So these rules are universal. Yeah.
That's the new trend that I'm noticing.
Yeah.
And people having a difficult time, or scholars having a difficult time trying to apply the usul of fiqh and giving fatwa for us in the non-Muslim world.
Yes. Yes, truly. Muslim minorities, there have been, by the way, throughout the Muslim history, Muslim minorities. There have been. And you will find in the fatwa a lot. Of fatawa for Muslims living in non-Muslim countries. There are, but it was never at such a big scale as it is in recent times. So probably that's one of the main needs, that really a lot of fiqh develops around the minorities. There have been some attempts, some scattered fatawa here and there, some books here and there, but no proper kind of development of fiqh for Muslim minorities, really, yes.
Fatwa regarding that issue. and then you have some scholars saying be patient and live at least the basics of this.
Yeah, life. Yeah.
And then wait patiently and handle it.
Yes.
As issues come about in the world.
We have to understand the limitation that the Muslim minorities living in non-Muslim countries is relatively new. And for fiqh to develop around this is going to take time. And it's not that the scholars are not giving fatawa. Scholars are trying to give their best, but scholars are also holding back because sometimes they understand, they don't necessarily relate fully to the circumstances. So this is why they're careful when they give their fatawa. And also, there are some trends that you'll find some people say, for example, we have to take everything from the scholars who are living in the Muslim countries. We have to refer to them, generally speaking. We have to. But we have to bridge that gap by having people, students of knowledge who are very strong, who are based here, who are connected to the scholars, who are able to bridge both worlds. This is missing. Although there is a great number of people who have studied overseas and so on, but they're not fulfilling this. So what you find, some of them decide to move to Muslim countries or still take the fatawa of the scholars as they are, as they apply to Muslim countries and try to force them here within a context where it might be very challenging to apply them or implement them. Or there might be certain characteristics that it cannot be applied in that fashion. But on the other side, you have people say, forget about those scholars, they don't understand anything about what we go through, forget about it, let's make our own rulings. That's also an extreme, which is not acceptable. Because still, the West has not really produced scholars of such high caliber. Let's face it. Maybe there's one or two here or there, but that's not enough. And even one or two over there, if they are not in touch with the scholars over there, if they do not create an open dialogue and create an intellectual environment where these ideas can be discussed back and forth and so on and so forth, I mean, the victim will be the Muslim minorities, still not being able. So you either take them to this extreme or that extreme, and still none of them is really working, because fiqh is not only, okay, let me do it and that's it. Fiqh has consequences. Because if you're doing what's haram, although someone is telling you it's halal, it's going to have consequences on your faith, on your circumstances. Yeah.
The trend that also the trend I've noticed, obviously, with a lot of Islamic institutes that are available here, like Al Kalfur.
Without naming the market.
You'll notice a trend that, I won't say name the people, I'm naming the institutions, but what tends to happen is you have Sheikh, quote unquote Sheikh, who study with the scholars in Saudi Arabia and America, and then they come here and they live as Muslims, as us, but they've studied there. And they come here and then they either disconnect from the scholars there, like that's the trend that you were talking about, and then the scholars there just kind of refute any type of knowledge that they were giving as students back then, back there, and now here it's like,
yeah.
There's a political divide.
Yes, there might be this divide. Okay, yes, some people are saying, okay, let's disconnect from those scholars, okay, because we want to build our own fiqh and so on and so forth. I don't see this as ideal, but sometimes we're very quick to judge as well. This is a transitional stage. This is a transitional stage. And what I think it will lead actually to, because if you take an extreme approach, it's going to backfire. So once it might take some time, and it will backfire, then people will still come back probably and find a more ideal situation. So I don't think we should jump quickly to labeling. I think we should see if someone is going to an extreme, probably try to, okay, they're trying to fill a gap, let's fill another gap. If there's some damage there, we minimize it. And if there's some shortcoming, why don't we complement each other? And I think Muslims need to think in that fashion instead of, oh, he's wrong and he's right. Specifically these times, this kind of approach is going to make you weaker regardless. The other person could be wrong, but you just saying this and taking an attitude just like that is going to have an impact on the overall Muslim community. You need to realize at some stage, as we said previously, like Imam Shafi'i saw that Ahl al-Hadith, for example, were holding so much to Hadith and not even seeing the meaning behind the Hadith. He didn't necessarily say that's wrong. And looking at Ahl al-Ra'i, he saw that they would sometimes elaborate so much on the meanings and depart away from the words. He didn't necessarily say that was wrong. He saw the merit there and the merit there, and he tried to bridge the gap, and that's why he brought a contribution. So this kind of either or black or white approach is really has been doing a lot of, you know, harm to the Muslims. I think we should take that in more brotherly fashion, and instead of accusing people with their intentions, because I see sometimes accusing people's intentions comes so much into play there. Or he has some hidden agenda. Oh, this person is connected to some other people. We don't know who they are. How can you come? This person, from their perspective, is coming with everything they can, okay? They're wrong. We have to acknowledge that, fine, but they have some good stuff. Let's see how we can minimize whatever, if there's harm there, how we can minimize it and bridge the gap. Because, you know, no one is going to be Allah's gift to the world, by the way, and solve the problem. It has to be collective. The challenge is so big that there is no individual who is able to solve it. Unless Al-Mahdi comes. But it's a collective. It's a collective. It's a we complement each other. We complete, you know, this whole drawing that we call fiqh. The structure of the report is, generally speaking, flexible. I don't want it to be more like a university thing. But generally speaking, you would have to have what we call a literature review. You know, give a background, basically, on what's the main topic you're talking about. Give a summary of the opinions, the different opinions. It's good to have a historical approach, yes. You can choose it, or you can say, you can have a chronicle, historical description, or you can have maybe, oh, the form of that, this is how they deal with it. So you can choose any kind of approach you want. It could be. It's up to you. Yeah. So you will see some people, yes, where the divide is getting bigger, yes, and these are pushing into this extreme, people are pushing into this extreme. But if you look at another group, you'll find there's another group that's actually taking from both and getting closer. So it's hard to read from now which trend will be the dominant. It's really hard to. But there is a great, as far as I can see, there's a good number of people who are actually standing in the middle. And they're less, I would say, They don't have like the reservation that those have against those or those have against those. So somehow, and this group in the middle is actually seems to be growing. And if you look at another group of people, you'll find some people completely disillusioned with all of this and they say forget about it. And some of our youth are actually leaving the deen altogether. Or you'll find some other group and they would say, you know, this is all historical stuff, let's leave it, and let's start understanding Quran with our own modern mentality. So it depends where you're looking at. Yes, there are so many people, and there are so many groups, so to speak, and each group is going in a different direction. But which trend will be the most dominant, that's really hard to read. It's really hard to read, yes. You should take knowledge from someone that you trust their knowledge in fiqh, you trust their aqidah, and you trust their religiosity as a person, the level of their righteousness and devotion and truthfulness as a person. And don't get involved in the rest. That's it. Because this kind of discussion, don't take from someone whose aqidah is questioned or someone who's this and that, okay? This is something truly, it's the students of knowledge and the scholars really, really understand. But this has been misused. So to make it more practical, so this has become an issue. Instead of becoming a solution, it became an issue. So you would find someone going around, people, and there are so many of those people, going around, what's his aqidah? What's your aqidah? Are you with the aqidah of this or that? And even among Ahlul Sunnah, there are issues where the scholars have differed around certain words. They've differed. Like at the time of Imam al-Bukhari, the issue of Khalqul Qur'an, there's a certain statement where this scholars of Ahlul Sunnah have differed about. So Imam Bukhari said that statement. People made takfir on him. And that's why he died, by the way. He died in distress because of that accusation. Yeah. So today you have people chasing the scholars of Ahlul Sunnah, where there are issues sometimes where the scholars disagree about certain wordings. And they say, he's mubtada', He's mubtada, he's mubtada, he's this, he's that. What's your aqidah? Started testing people. And this became an issue. And the problem is that it has become an outlet for people's ego. People say, I'm protecting the deen, I'm careful who to take religion from. No, no, but you just saw narcissists, you want to put people down, and this came as a way for you to express it, which sounds legitimate to you. It has become political. So what I recommend is, you find a scholar that you trust their aqidah, because you trust their aqidah, where do you trust their aqidah from? How did you get this decision? How did you make this decision? You don't have knowledge, so how do you trust their aqidah? I know, you don't know. How do you trust their aqidah? Oh, you know, the scholars have, how do you know these scholars, their recommendation, how do you know that they are on the correct aqidah? Basically, when you don't have knowledge, you're baseless. So basically, what I say, follow the scholar that you truly respect their aqidah, that is based on the aqidah of the early generations. Hold on to that person, learn from him or their students, if you don't have direct access to them, from their students, to be a bridge for you to that, towards that person, and hold your tongue back. You doubt someone's aqidah or someone's issues, don't take from them, but don't talk about them. That's none of your business. That's none of your business. That's the problem, that people thought, I'm defending the deen. They started slandering the scholars, left, right, and center, and everything. Now, who to take knowledge from? When you advance in knowledge to a certain extent, where you feel safe to take from that person who has knowledge in that area, and I don't find that level of knowledge with other, I don't have access to scholars upon the correct aqidah who have this knowledge. So I do study. So this is why among some of the scholars that you will find today, even the very well-known scholars that we know, they've studied with this and that when he has an issue with aqidah, but they studied with him, for example, the Arabic language, and so on and so forth. So is aqidah and fiqh? Aqidah and fiqh is all related. This kind of, you know, separation is just for academic study. But everything is related. But now, take fiqh from where? Where do we mainly, if we want to understand Sahih Bukhari, where do we go to? Fath al-Bari. Fath al-Bari. Who is it written by? Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani. Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, what was his aqidah? Ash'ari. All the scholars of Ahlul Sunnah take from his Sharh Muslim. Where do we go to for Sharh Muslim mainly now? Sharh al-Nawawi. Al-Nawawi was what? Mainly Ash'ari. Why didn't the scholars of Ahlul Sunnah dump these books? So we have to be careful about how to deal with these issues. So advice, the practical advice, is basically take from a person that you trust their aqidah, their fiqh, their knowledge, their tools, and their religiosity, and the sense of fairness, and so on, their ethics. Take from them, and don't get into all that political stuff, because it's taking people away from even the truth.
Yeah, especially Muslims, you know, that come to us, you want to direct them to some type of path where they can study. You know, they get into the whole fourth thing. Who should they follow?
New Muslims or new practicing people will get them straight into the politics. This person's aqidah is dodgy. This person is that. Warn against that person. Haram, these people want to learn about Allah. Teach them about Allah, about the Rasul, about Rasulullah, about the hadith. Teach them how to pray and how to do this. And you believe, for example, take from Shaykh Ibn Uthaymeen, okay? Tell him, okay, learn from that scholar. Learn from his books. A lot of his books have been translated. A lot of his students are around. A lot of them are English speaking. So learn from them. And that's the advice I give you. But you don't create a monopoly over this person. Okay, you are mine. You are mine, basically. So if you take who to take from, you have to consult with me. I mean, you don't have this authority over them. Tomorrow they will dump you, right?
Yeah. I think.
Jazakumullah khairan. Was nice having you here. I said I also await your feedback. So whatever feedback, whether it's positive, negative, feel free. No reservations there, inshallah. Anything we can use, inshallah, to improve.